So maybe I can do a scope of today's lesson. Reproduction, but I'd just like to go back to this. Here you see a raspberry flower developing. You can see the stigmas on the inside. Fertilization has occurred, the anthers are wilting and beginning to fall off. Then you see all the small little ovaries begin to enlarge from the stigmas. And each stigma leads to one ovary and it's enlarging. When you look at a raspberry fruit, it is an aggregate of many fruits. It's an aggregate of many tiny fruits. Okay, then you'll start to turn red. And so when you eat one raspberry, you're actually eating a bundle of many tiny little fruits. Same for the strawberry. Strawberry, actually it comes with many small little ovaries on the outside. Then each stigma leads to an ovary that gets fertilized. And previously during our practical, I shared that when you look at strawberry, actually each seed is a fruit. Right? Evidence of that, you can see small little stigma onto each of the seed. So in fact, you can tear open one of those seeds and you'll find the seed, the real seed inside. Okay. Well, I restart my Okay, could you take out your textbooks? Okay, we'll start today with a little snack. Okay, I brought raspberries and strawberries so that we can have a look up close. See for yourself. Everybody can take either a strawberry or a raspberry. Right, as it goes around, you just take one and go have a look. Right, you can pluck out one of the fruits. You can remove all the fruits of the strawberry. Means if you want to, you can even open up the strawberry fruit, the real fruit. Yeah? Okay, so raspberry going this way. Raspberry, wash them. Okay, if you are allergic to berries, you got your hand sanitizers, maybe it'll be great to sanitize your hand first. Or you can take a tissue paper and then you can grab one of the fruits. Yeah, okay. been meaning to buy the strawberries for a while, but all the strawberries I see at supermarket is very dented. Finally, yesterday I saw a nice one. Okay, have a look at the raspberry. Can you see this leftover stigma?
No,
I thought maybe you'll observe a little bit first. Okay, observe while you think. You have to remember you're biting to the receptacle of the strawberry. Maybe you want to pluck all the fruits out of the strawberry. It should be still quite cold. I think the raspberry is quite calm. Each fruit is a little bit. It can allow. Can you remove the individual fruits of the raspberry?
It's not
any leftover stigmas? You also find this on the blackberry? Anyone manage to pluck out a single strawberry fruit? Yeah. You open up their fruit. I've never opened it up before. I'm very curious what a strawberry seed looks like. I've got a teaser. Yeah, I'm not sure if there's enough strawberry to go around. Meanwhile, as we go into the final stretch of human reproduction, Okay, good question. What is the largest cell in the human body?
Cell.
Yeah. Sorry?
Sperm.
Sperm cell?
Nerve cell.
Nerve cell? Actually, one of the largest cells in the human body.
Stem cell.
Okay, so we make a comparison. If that's a coffee bean, that's a rice grain, let's zoom in. That'll be a sesame seed. Sesame seed is almost the size of sesame seed is bigger than a strawberry fruit. Okay, grain of salt, amoeba, paramecia. Okay, that's a human egg. That's the sperm. That's the tiny little sperm over there. Over there, that's the sperm. That's an egg. Okay, in relation to your skin cell, your red blood cell, and then that's the chromosomes, and that's the mitochondria. I go deeper and deeper, viruses, all the viruses, the antibodies that you study, hemoglobin, the protein, phospholipids. Okay, and that's a single carbon atom. So if you zoom all the way up, human egg and sperms, then they are. Do you know the human egg is actually a cell you can see without a microscope? Right? It's visible just as it is. So that's a coin. Can you see that white speck over there? That's a human egg. For real, yeah? That's a human egg. That's one of the few cells in the body that you can see. Oh. Anyone has not had a Anyone not have a strawberry? It sounds romantic. Oh, okay. Yeah, so I'll play again. The human egg is actually invisible. Okay, so you don't actually need a microscope to see the human egg. That's like 10 eggs put together. No, that's not a yolk, that's just like a bubble of water to contain the eggs. Okay, so today we're going into fertilization and beyond. What happens post-fertilization? What's the structure of the egg? What's the structure of the sperm? This is the structure of human egg. I put the reference pages on the bottom just so that you can go to relevant pages if you want to take down notes. Okay? This is something you've covered before in JH2, the structure of the human egg. Right? If I go to the human sperm, I think this one is a little bit more familiar. Right? When we look at the structure of the human sperm, it comes with all these parts, from a tail, to a mid-piece, to a head. Head is where you find the nucleus, the mid-piece is where you find all the mitochondria. We have learned in JH2 that mitochondria, the mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell, right? It is the site where ATP is synthesized. And ATP is the cell's currency for energy. That's what keeps the sperm so active. Whereas when we look at the structure of the human egg, it's a little bit more complicated. Truly, the egg is in the middle. Right? You see that round structure? That is the egg. Can you recall, this egg is paused at a certain stage of meiosis. Metaphase 2. Okay? It's paused at metaphase 2, this particular egg. Right? It's something we didn't quite say in JH2, but it wouldn't have made sense. But now to you, remember that actually it has started meiosis, but it has taken a short break. But what's relevant for us at this point is to know that there are additional structures surrounding the egg. First, there is a glycoprotein layer called the zona pellucida. Is it shown here? So it's a thick white layer, it's a glycoprotein layer. We'll see why all this is necessary and where it comes into play later on. You also see the corona radiata made out of follicular cells. Where did these follicular cells come from? I wonder. Okay, it came from the follicles. Right, when we were studying how eggs ovulate, right, remember, after they ovulate, what you're left with is the corona radiata. And actually, the egg carries along with it some of the follicular cells. So, the egg cells come with a lot of cells surrounding them. It's like a that party. Before the sperm comes, right, they have a whole last party before they are good friends from back in the hometown. Okay? Inside, you will often see inside, maybe it's not drawn there, but you could draw it in also, small little vesicles called cortical granules. These granules contain chemicals that will later on help to modify the structure of the zona pellucida, make it impenetrable. Like no more sperms can go through. Okay, so broadly, we do expect you to know the structure of the human egg, but more in context of what its purpose is. Okay, so human egg as well as the human sperm. Most notable adaptations of the human sperm are the acrosome and the mitochondria. Okay, the mitochondria, as you know, they supply energy in the form of ATP. And when we talk about the acrosome, it contains a lot of what we call hydrolytic enzymes. What do you think they are for? Okay, it helps to hydrolyze. It helps to hydrolyze that particular layer, the zona pellucida. The jelly-like, the glycoprotein layer that surrounds the egg. So that is the barrier that the sperm needs to penetrate through before it can actually fertilize the egg underneath. Okay? So it contains hydrolytic enzymes. So if you ever see the word hydrolytic enzymes, means hydro means water, lytic means like lysis, that you want to break something. So it's hydrolytic enzymes. How do you think sperms move? Okay. Like a tadpole? Okay. Have you seen like videos of sperms like moving like that? Like a tadpole, right? Oh, but actually, right, it is an optical illusion. For 250 years, people have always thought sperms move this way. Even videos also depict it as a tadpole moving, kind of like slithering like a snake. But it's only in recent years, after we invented technology, that we realized that the sperm moves not this way, but this is what we always see from the top view. Left, right.
During sexual intercourse, about 300 million sperm enter the vagina. Soon afterward, millions of them leave the flow out of the vagina or die in its acidic environment. However, many survive because of the protective elements provided in the fluid surrounding them. Next, the sperm must pass through the cervix and opening into the uterus. Usually, it remains tightly closed, but here the cervix is open for a few days while the woman ovulates. The sperm swim through the cervical mucus, which is thinned to a more watery consistency for easier passage. Once inside the cervix, the sperm continues swimming toward the uterus, though millions will die trying to make it through the mucus. Some sperm remain behind, caught in the folds of the cervix, but they may later continue the journey as backup to the first group. Inside the uterus, muscular uterine contractions assist the sperm on their journey toward the egg. However, resident cells from the woman's immune system, mistaking the sperm for foreign invaders, destroy thousands more. Next, half the sperm head for the empty fallopian tube, while the other half swim toward the tube containing the unfertilized egg. Now, only a few thousand remain. Inside the fallopian tube, tiny cilia push the egg toward the uterus. To continue, the sperm must surge against this motion to reach the egg. Some sperm get trapped in the cilia and die. During this part of the journey, chemicals in the reproductive tract cause the membranes covering the heads of the sperm to change. As a result, the sperm become hyperactive, swimming harder and faster toward their destination. At long last, the sperm reach the egg. Only a few dozen of the original 300 million sperm remain. The egg is covered with a layer of cells called the corona radiata. The sperm must push through this layer to reach the outer layer of the egg, the zona pellucida. When sperm reach the zona pellucida, they attach to specialized sperm receptors on the surface, which triggers their acrosomes to release digestive enzymes, enabling the sperm to burrow into the layer. Inside the zona pellucida is a narrow, fluid-filled space just outside the egg cell membrane. The first sperm to make contact will fertilize the egg. After a perilous journey and against incredible odds, a single sperm attaches to the egg cell membrane. Within a few minutes, their outer membranes fuse and the egg pulls the sperm inside. This event causes changes in the egg membrane that prevent other sperm from attaching to it. Next, the egg releases chemicals that push other sperm away from the egg and create an impenetrable fertilization membrane. As the reaction spreads outward, the zona pellucida hardens, trapping any sperm unlucky enough to be caught inside. Outside the egg, sperm are no longer able to attach to the zona pellucida. Meanwhile, inside the egg, the tightly packed male genetic material spreads out. A new membrane forms around the genetic material, creating the male pronucleus. Inside, the genetic material reforms into 23 chromosomes. The female genetic material, awakened by the fusion of the sperm with the egg, finishes dividing, resulting in the female pronucleus, which also contains 23 chromosomes. As the male and female pronuclei form, spider-like threads, called microtubules, pull them toward each other. The two sets of chromosomes join together, completing the process of fertilization. At this moment, a unique genetic code arises, instantly determining gender, hair color, eye color, and hundreds of other characteristics. This new single cell, the zygote, is the beginning of a new human being. And now the cilia in the fallopian tube gently sweep the zygote toward the uterus, where he or she
the obstacles these 300 million sperms have faced? The ideal acidic environment. Anything else? Okay, I hear cervix. And the cervix may not necessarily be open. I've heard immune response. After all, these are foreign cells. Okay, so naturally the female body will want to destroy them. Anything else?
Cilia.
Okay, yeah, you sweep against the cilia, which is sweeping out of the female body. Sorry, the sperm needs to travel against the sweeping effect of the cilia. Anything else? Okay, choosing the correct fallopian tube. You just make the wrong turn, even if you make it all the way to the end, it's hopeless. Okay, the correct fallopian tube. All of this FYI, just for you to appreciate. Yeah, for you to appreciate. Okay, anything else? Any other obstacles it faces? Okay, so the two obstacles that are more important for you are these two. The corona radiata, which is this layer over here, in the layer of cells. This is obstacle number one, corona radiata. The second obstacle would be this layer called the zona pellucida. Okay? These two are also obstacles that the sperms will have to encounter and make it through. I also heard that they can get trapped in the folds, right? Trapped in the folds along the way and never may not make it through. Maybe you can track the cilia. Okay, so for your understanding, right, as we come to the idea of fertilization, we always know fertilization as the process where a sperm fuses with an egg. But truly, for that to really happen, it has to overcome two more barriers. The first one will be to push its way through all the follicular cells, which is the corona radiata. Right, push through the crown first. Meet the lady in the middle. Right? So that's the first obstacle to overcome. Next, we know that the sperm comes with a vesicle called the acrosome that contains a lot of hydrolytic enzymes. The enzymes' role is not to digest these cells on the outside. Okay? So they don't digest the cells on the outside, they just get pushed through. The digestion takes place over here when you want to digest through the zona pellucida. So let's say I have a sperm that has made its way up here. Okay, from here onwards is where I want to start doing some digestion. Okay, is that the best way to say? Some hydrolysis, right? Breaking down glycoproteins. And then you saw for the sperms that managed to make their way through, some may fuse to the egg cell membrane. Okay. This fusion will result in whatever is inside the sperm go in, all its genetic material. And then there will be an intermingling of all the DNA. Okay, but here's the thing, how do we prevent more than one sperm fusing with that one egg? Right? Sorry?
Yeah,
there's some chemical change that takes place by the egg. What the egg does is this. So this is where the corona radiata comes in. Yeah, the cortical granules, not corona radiata. The cortical granules. Okay. In your textbook, they will have written this process as the cortical reaction. The cortical reaction, to put it very simply, is that these vesicles will migrate towards the cell membrane. Yeah, exocytosis will occur to release the chemicals, but these chemicals cause something quite spectacular. It causes the zona pellucida layer to harden and become impenetrable to any other sperm that may have made its way through the corona radiata. So it's only one egg, one sperm. Right. So, for your understanding, the cortical reaction is important, as well as over here, the role of the acrosome. In your textbook, describe this as the acrosome reaction. This is when all the hydrolytic enzymes will be released to help digest through the zona pellucida layer. Okay? Okay, number one and number two. Right? And once it's fused and the DNA has intermingled with each other, that's when we consider it as fertilization. Okay? Okay, that's on page 45 of your textbook. So after fertilization, where does it go next? Right? Okay. So from from fertilization onwards, the zygote will then begin to develop and grow. Yeah? Okay, this diagram over here just gives you a quick summary of the various processes that will take place for fertilization that take place. Okay, if you want to attach such an image to your textbook, it's all found on Google, or I think we've already attached one diagram for you in the textbook. Okay, so it's very brief description. Okay, don't need to know who is that. Okay, right, after which the sperm. This is a real image of the sperms trying to go through the corona radii earlier. Okay, so this is a real egg in the middle. Surrounding it, you can see that thick corona radiata, lots of additional follicular cells. And then can you see the sperms on the outside? Yeah? Okay, so they're trying to make their way through the crowd eventually to the egg.
Why was this film?
I like it in a petri dish. Now it's not very well lit. Like in a petri dish, you can light it up better. But likely, that being said, this is most likely not what you would actually observe, because this is done in a lab. Right? Very often, things done in a lab and in vivo means in the body, it's very different. So we may not actually get to see what actually happens. You know, in recent years, they found a way to aid sperms in the fertilization process. So see, they designed a small little nanobot that's like a little spring that helps to deliver the sperms. You see, captures the tail and then it brings it to the egg. And when we talk about fertilization, in reality, it's not always 100% thing. Some couples find it really tough to even get this process through. So there have been many ways, a lot of research being done to help push this front. Now we move from zygote to fetus. This over here is a frog zygote that is slowly dividing. Notice that it's dividing pretty fast, and we call this is mitosis taking place, not meiosis, yeah. Okay, so what's interesting here, notice when we talk about mitosis, we always say that it divides into two cells, and then the cells tend to be the same size, right? But over here, what you observe is that the cells get smaller and smaller every time they divide. Yeah. What's actually happening here is that, the cell cycle, there's the growth phase, right? In the growth phase at the early stages, it's much shorter. So not much time to accumulate a lot more cytoplasm to make sure each cell is bigger. So make sure the main cell is bigger before dividing. So the cells just become smaller and smaller and smaller first. The aim is to just get as many cells as possible. So growth phase is rather short. Okay, from zygote to fetus, page 46. Okay, on page 46, the key terms for you to identify, for you to know. Number one is zygote. Okay, from zygote, we want to go to this structure called blastocysts. From blastocysts, we want to go to the next thing called fetus. Then finally, the embryo. And then the fetus. If you were to take our module on human development in university, let's say you take medicine or biology, they will go in depth to teach you about the various stages after the zygote has been formed. It is a fascinating process, and they often compare with other animals to see how other animals also develop. And very often what we realize is that, and other animals in us, at very early stages, we all look the same. The process that we go through is the same. We go from zygote, blastocyst, embryo. Actually, we still look quite similar only up to the later stages, when the main features start to come out. For your understanding at our level, all you need to know is that zygote becomes blastocyst, this becomes this, and this becomes this. Right? But if you are interested, you can go read up more. For university, what you do is that they'll teach you exactly all the intermediaries, right, of what happens in each step. I'd like to show you a video so that you can understand what the blastocyst looks like, what an embryo looks like, what a fetus looks like.
In this video event, we'll look at the beginning of development, looking into the ovary at an unfertilized egg. It then gets fertilized by sperm, which travel down the fallopian tube. So here, millions of sperm coming along. Several of them will hit the egg and try to penetrate it, but one will win, as it were, go into the nucleus, and then there's a reprogramming process where the male and female nuclei have their genes set aside to be turned on and off for early development. Here you see early cleavage stages occurring, and this is one of the early growth phases. As the embryo moves down the fallopian tube, it's going to form an important stage called the blastocyst here in a few seconds. Of course, in real life that takes days, about 5 days. At this stage then, I'd like to draw your attention to the inside of the blastocyst, where there are cells called the inner cell mass, which I'll be abbreviating as ICM. Those are the cells that make the entire...
Right. So, the blastocyst is actually a ball of cells, or rather a hollow ball of cells. It may look like just one ball, but truly, if you look, it's a layer of cells that form a hollow core. Plus, you eat the onde-onde, yeah, think of the blastocyst as onde-onde, but with an empty core in the middle.
In this video then, blastocyst, where there are cells called the entire animal, and the outer cells give rise to the placenta and other supporting tissues. At this stage, the embryo implants into the wall of the uterus. This is when a pregnancy is really initiated. And now we'll see those blue inner cell mass cells form a disc, and then as the cells continue to grow, they change their physical positions, their kind of geographical relationship to one another. And you see that represented here as this disc gets transformed into an embryo. Those lines represent sites where cells are migrating in and out. And here's an important stage when the three beginning layers of the embryo, the so-called germ layers, are formed. And I'll come back to that in a few minutes. As development proceeds, there's more growth and movement of cells. It'll begin to form a neural tube. Here it turns, and appendages start to bud out. You see the head forming and the eye, and then eventually we get a small embryo, and some months later, of course, this would be born as a young baby.
Right, so when we differentiate the terms, I think that's what we say before 8 weeks, we refer to it as embryo. Beyond 8 weeks, you can refer to it as a fetus. Okay, so no need for deep details, but if you're interested, there's actually a whole big field on embryo development. But I think what's more interesting is to see a real embryo development take place. I've shown you this video before, yeah? Remember a long time ago, cell division? Okay, but now, with new lens, we watch the process again for a short while, and you can see the process again taking place. A long time ago, I showed you cell division. Okay, so this is fertilization. Then after fertilization has taken place, the cells will undergo mitosis, the zygote will undergo mitosis. Multiple times, so 1, 2, 4, 8. Not much time in the growth phase, so they just get smaller and smaller and smaller. Later on, then the cells will grow. This may look like a ball of cells, but at the core, it's actually hollow. After 8 weeks, we'll start to refer to this as an embryo. Sorry, before 8 weeks, it is an embryo. So this is still an embryo. After 8 weeks, we'll start to refer to it as a fetus. Now you can see all the cells start to differentiate. From blood cells, you start to get other tissues forming. In the dawn, you'll see the heartbeats. Oh, okay. So I think we can slowly start to call this a fetus. called plum, right? Plum. 4 months, okay, 4 months, pear. Pear. Mango, okay, mango. Okay, around there. Mango at around week 20. So like, week 24, large grapefruit. Grapefruit around this size, right? Okay, so this is week 24 already. Yeah. Okay, week 28, iceberg lettuce. Right? Right, iceberg lettuce around this size, right? Or even bigger. Pineapple, week 32. Oh, this is around a big pineapple. So around this size, a pineapple, week 32. Oh, okay, week 36. Okay, week 40, week 140 is a watermelon. So it's towards the tail end already. 40, this is around 10 months right here. Okay. So around week 10, that's the size of the watermelon. Quite accurate if you think about it. Yes. So it's week 10. Week 10 just nice for me. So, you know, last year when I come up, when I did in 2019, at week 10, right, the balloon burst in my face. My response to the kids was that that's why it needs to come out. So, I find it quite cute that you can compare it to a fruit size, makes it a little bit more relatable. But yeah, your chest before birth is kind of like the size of a watermelon. But the mouth looks much bigger than the watermelon because there's still a lot of layers of tissue of her own skin. And then there is the sac that will enclose the baby, a lot of things that will protect the baby. That's where we're going to go to next. I'm going to talk about how a fetus grows and survives within the baby. Again, we don't need to know in depth how a fetus grows and develops inside the baby. No, how the fetus grows and develops inside the mom. Okay, without reading the textbook, we're going to try something, yeah? Okay, don't look at your textbook, lah. Okay, I'd like you to now scan this QR code. Okay, we're going to try and make sense of how a fetus can get nutrients from mommy. Yeah, I'd like you to think of think through these three questions, and we'll slowly collect your responses. To grow as well as an outlet for the waste it will produce. Speaking of waste, I learned that my ants, right? So as my ants go into the metamorphosis stage, they actually don't have anywhere to poop. They are inside a cocoon. So what they do, right, is that they'll just poop inside the cocoon. So if you ever see a cocoon of an ant for some reason, you'll find at the very base of the cocoon a small little black spot. That black spot is where it shits inside its own cocoon. So where does the baby's waste go? Nutrients, oxygen, waste removal. Okay? A placenta in a suitable environment. What does suitable environment mean? Oops, let me go back. Placenta in a suitable environment. What do you mean by a suitable environment? Oxygen for respiration. Okay, a little bit more in depth. Oxygen for respiration. hydration, water, nutrients to grow. Love. Quite true, huh? There's a lot of talk, you know, whether baby can learn while inside the mom's tummy, right? Now, in fact, now even when I say tummy, right, it's a little bit off, right? You know, baby doesn't balance and stuff. So love. Some parents just don't play like Mozart, you know, put the headphones here and then. Or maybe they read. Anyone, you know, remember the time? No, you don't remember. But did anyone tell the guardian or parent tell you about how they read you and you're still inside? Have a play music? Oh, yeah, yeah. After looking at the posters, maybe come out. Maybe it's something to learn from them. I also heard this thing, you know, last time my grandma, right, would tell my mom, right, you stop watching this cartoon show because all the creatures inside look very ugly. So she loved watching this show of dinosaurs, and the dinosaurs look hideous. So she banned my mom from watching that particular show when I was developing inside. Yeah. So, okay, some playing music, some songs, right? My deep quadratic patients. No lah. Okay, so I need food. Hey, okay. Hey, something wrong with my keyboard, so I can only go right but not left. So I need to restart all this. Okay, let's see. Oxygen, nutrients. A sperm and an egg. How do a fetus need a sperm and an egg? It won't need, it came from the sperm and the egg. Okay, so this is what you think a fetus would need, right? The next, how would a fetus get what it needs? Okay, from the mommy, but how? Specifically how? Umbilical cord. Wow, okay, everyone's placenta, umbilical cord. What do you mean, Mr. Tan? Maybe if I'm a seahorse, maybe, yeah. What means blood through the umbilical cord? Placenta, because a fetus is a parasite. Actually, in many ways, a fetus is like a parasite. But just get nutrients from the mom. Through the mother from the umbilical cord. Lots of placenta, umbilical cord. But it is poop. Okay, does it eat poop? Did you recycle, like, who goes in, who comes out, then you just recycle over it? Did that happen? Okay. What we have agreed on is that it comes from mommy, right? It seems like we think that the placenta and umbilical cord plays an important role. That's that connection. And then, in fact, the remnant or the scar of that connection is still here. Yeah? Anyone here got no belly button? Yeah, it's quite scary, right? You don't have a belly button. Who owns this, huh? Okay, so now for the next part, I'm going to try to figure out that connection. How in the world does baby connect mommy? Okay. It is a little bit of fun, huh? Without looking at a textbook, don't look at a textbook. Alright, I'd like you to use your imagination. Alright, draw in as much detail as possible on this sheet of paper how you think the fetus is connected to the mother. You know that there's an umbilical cord, right? But how does this connection really take place? Try to make sense of it. Right? If you think it needs nutrients, how is it getting the nutrients from the mom? Thank you. So this is what we're going to do. In the next 6 minutes, I'd like you to, using your imagination, how do you think the fetus is connected to the mother to get what you think it requires? You see, it requires nutrients, it requires oxygen, it needs to remove waste. Okay, after you draw, we're going to do a little bit of sharing. Okay, as you draw, I'd like you to consider how it's getting its oxygen, nutrients specifically. Does it get it from mommy's intestines? Like baby's intestine going through the umbilical cord of the mom's intestines. Our heart connected to the mom's baby get the food, the oxygen. How does it get rid of the waste? Does it have a poop bag within the mom? It needs to be removed. How do you think fetus is getting the nutrients from mom? Yourself, what do you draw? Okay, so like baby's blood vessels, and then mom's blood vessels, and that connection must be what's supplying the nutrients. How about the waste? So over here, I'm seeing that blood vessels are involved, right, between mom and baby. Okay, I'd like you now to share with your table partner and explain to them how you think baby is getting nutrients, oxygen, removing waste.
Thank you.
Okay, as I'm going around, I see quite a number of interesting drawings. Okay, I'll let one of you, right, if you find your partner's drawing really interesting, right, and you'd like to share, please raise your hand now. Anyone would like to share your partner's drawing? Can you share your partner's drawing, but not you share your one. No? Yes, I was walking around, I see several interesting points. Okay, we all agree that the fetus needs oxygen, he needs nutrients, and he needs to get rid of waste. Agree? Yeah? Okay. Where would one a fetus tap on to get these two things? Okay, mummy's blood. Okay, as I was walking around, one thing's very common. Everyone is tapping baby's blood, mummy's blood. Right? So somehow we must get all this. Right? Our baby doesn't eat per se. Right? It's not like you see the mom shove the apple through the belly button and knocks from there. Doesn't take place that way, right? So somehow we must get already pre-digested, pre-absorbed oxygen. Where can we get it from? Perhaps it's mom's blood. Mom's blood. The next level I saw was that, you know, perhaps let's make a connection. If this is the baby, let's connect the baby's blood vessels to perhaps mom's blood vessels. And these blood vessels may then go on to the small intestines, to mom's heart, right? And that way we can connect the two and then make sure blood from mom is going to the baby also. Right? That's what I've seen so far. Waste. How would one remove waste? That's a baby. So actually, by blood. Actually, it's by blood. The baby doesn't need to eat, so there's actually no leftover materials to poop out. Right? If you think about it, we poop, whatever we poop out is like all the fiber, right? That we couldn't digest. Baby's not doing that. So technically, blood waste can also be removed by mom's blood. Puwet. Correct, puwet. Where do you think you'll go? Kidney, the renal system. So waste should go to the kidneys, the renal system for removal. Where would the oxygen come from? Whose lungs? Mom's lungs. Where would the nutrients come from? Mom's small intestines. Okay, so it seems like the only way we can get nutrients, the baby, is to get it from mom's blood. Perhaps through a connection. Right? Now I want you to think, are there any issues if we connect baby's blood system to mom's blood system? Agglutination, what about? Okay. What if baby's blood type is different from mommy's blood type? Yeah. Mom has blood type of A, baby blood type of B. Is that possible? Or maybe? Mom's AB, then baby. What if it's different blood types? How? Right, if it's a connection that we're making, right? We make a connection, what's going to make sense? Different blood types. Any other issues if we connect baby's blood system to mommy's blood system? I hear blood pressure. You think about this, baby's tiny little heart, then mommy's big heart, right? Mommy loves baby with a big heart, but that love may, you know, pressure difference. There's an issue of pressure difference also. One pump of mom, right, means it bursts all the blood vessels on the baby. Yeah. Any other issues? Earlier on I said, one of you said it's like baby's kind of like a parasite. Right? Kind of, imagine mom's immune system. So how? I saw something quite ingenious. Crystal suggested perhaps, why not we have a filter of some sort? Yeah? Right? If there's a filter of some sort, perhaps we can prevent all this. Perhaps we can prevent things like the things from mom's immune system getting across to baby's immune system. Right? Okay. So how is baby truly connected to mommy? Okay, I'm going to show you the structure. Okay, if you cannot sum up this, maybe don't look at it. Okay, you all talk a lot about the center. Right? How does this fit into the picture, right? Umbilical cord is the most obvious.
This is hot.
Right, but the placenta. Okay, so you cannot stomach this up. Okay, so the placenta looks something like this. Okay. So this is the umbilical cord. This is where the baby was connected to. On the top, you see this large sac. Right? That is the placenta. The placenta is like a little plastic bag of blood. How can we resolve all these issues and still maintain a connection to the mom? Okay? I'd like you to now look at page 47 of your textbook. Give the two paragraphs a quick read. See if it makes sense to you. And I'm going to depict the drawing on the board in a while. To you while you're reading your textbook, right? In reality, mom and baby's blood never mix, never touch, right? But we are still able to transfer nutrients between each other. Your textbook, they will say that at early stages, something called villus develops. Right? I'm going to draw the villus now. The villus will start to grow and embed itself into the mom's endometrium layer. The endometrium layer is made up of mom's tissue, lots of blood vessels. Your textbook then said the villus then begins to digest the area, surrounding area, right? Hydrolysis takes place, right? Was it there? Yeah? Okay, so this is what it looks like. The villus is entered. Now you start to kind of... And the villus comes with all the blood vessels of the baby. Okay? What happens next is quite interesting. The villus will then secrete enzymes to digest the surrounding area of the mom's endometrium. In fact, not just digest the tissues around the area, it also digests some of mom's blood vessels. Kind of opening up mom's blood vessels to enter, now break free. What the baby has essentially developed is this. After all the digestion is created a space, in a sense a cavity, right? It's created a cavity within the endometrium layer. This is through all the digestion that takes place. Now look, it's also digested a little bit of mom's blood vessels. So what's happening now? Mom's blood will now pour into this space. Mom's blood will pour into this space and fill up this cavity. It can also leave the cavity, go back to mom. The placenta is made up of all these cavities, Yeah, kind of like, that's why you saw the placenta is kind of like a large water balloon. Yeah? The water balloon is just a space with a collection of mom's blood pouring into it. But baby's blood never touches mom's blood because there is still a layer of epithelial cell protecting baby's blood from mom's blood directly. So a lot of diffusion takes place between the two layers. But baby's blood never touches mom's blood. So imagine we travel, right? This entire bubble layer needs to be removed. Yeah. But don't worry, during childbirth, all these blood vessels, right, will seal up. Blood clotting will take place, so mom won't lose excessive amount of blood. So just take note, inside the placenta, the blood that you find inside the placenta is mom's blood. Not baby's blood. The baby's blood never touches mom's blood. If it does, actually there will be a lot of from blood pressure, antibodies. Okay, so think of it as a swimming pool. Okay, so that is the placenta and the umbilical cord. Okay, I'll end off today. In our next lesson, I will just talk a little bit more about the remaining structure, which is the amniotic sac, to keep the baby in, cushion. Right? But we are mostly done with the chapter. Next lesson, I'd like you to complete the RE5.3 by 5th August. Yeah. There isn't a lot of questions pertaining to the last few parts of the lesson, mainly the front few parts. Okay, so that is all for today's lesson.